Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Christ the King Sunday, November 26, 2017. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. We have a guest pastor today, Pastor Bonnie Kinnunen.
This is in honor of Christ the King Sunday, honoring Jesus' role as King of all creation. Crown Him with Many Crowns was written by Matthew Bridges in the 1800s. English hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And let us pray together the prayer of the day. O God of power and light, your Son showed us the way of service,
and in him we inherited the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right, and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Connie Singleton will be reading the lessons.
Far above all rule and authority and power, and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, O Christ. We have special music today, provided by Martha and her daughter, Colin.
Thank you. when the year of the church concludes. And then what happens next Sunday? Next Sunday begins the first Sunday of Advent, and the church calendar goes around again and again. Christ the King Sunday was implemented or instituted in 1925 by Pope Pius XI. He wanted to set aside a day of the church year that Christ would be honored as the King and as the one who is sovereign over all of the world and all that is to be. In our text this Sunday, we will find the sovereign God whom Jesus always pointed to in his teachings, leading as a shepherd in Ezekiel. A shepherd is gathering in his beloved, the wayward flock, bringing them out of the darkness into light, out of hunger to fulfillment, and out of destructive chaos into safety. The Psalms proclaim praise for this God who cared for the people, leading them into beauty and an abundance of creation. Ephesians speaks to us about God who leads with the wisdom and power revealed in a fullness through the Son, Jesus Christ. And Matthew gives us the third story, the final parable in the Gospel of Matthew, just before Jesus goes to Gethsemane, Calvary, and gives us the third story about Jesus discussing the last days with his disciples before his arrest. In the story, we hear of a king sitting on a throne separating the sheep from the goats, those faithful to the ways of God's kingdom and those negligent in God's ways. Recently, I saw a video on that ever so famous thing called Facebook. And on the video, it was talking about traditions at Christmas and that how somewhere in the world, and I don't know the validity of this, but I thought the story was cute. Somewhere in the world, there was a tradition that when the Christmas party was held for the children, the first person in was someone who was dressed like the devil. And he carried a big sack with him and an ugly mask with horns on his head. And his whole point was to intimidate the children. And he would go up to each one of them and say, "Were you naughty this year? Were you nice?" And he would carry this big sack, and he said, "If you're naughty, I'm going to throw you in the sack, and we're going to go to that place where bad children go." And in the video, you see the kids show faces of horror and ponder as they contemplate that last 365 days. And if you know children like I know children, they weren't all angels on those 365 days. And the children were crying and showing great upset that the devil should cause the judgment and cast them out into the hither yard. But then there was Santa Claus, who came in after the devil had gotten everything all riled up and the kids were crying and boo-hooing and all sorts of commotion was carrying on. And Santa kicked the devil out the door and gave everybody Christmas. It was a sign of grace, pure grace. The children knew that they didn't deserve that grace. The children understood that, no, they hadn't been great for the last 365 days. They knew that they were not the best of children they could possibly be. And Santa Claus came in as a benevolent, grace-filled entity that made sure that all of the children were blessed and graced with his presence and gifted appropriately. Timeless, interesting story on the lookup between good and bad. And we hear in this story the separation of the sheep and the goats, and the only differentiation between one or the other is how the people behaved. I could belabor how the people behaved, but I just want to touch on it briefly and talk about seeing the needs in others. I took a look at your mission statement from your website, and could anybody tell me what that mission statement is? Geez, I don't see any quick raised hands there. It's really a great mission statement. I would encourage you to read it together. It says, "We care We share our blessings. We dare to give. We dare to live as God's people in the world. The mission statement says we care for one another, God's earth, and ourselves. We share our blessings, and we dare to live as God's people in God's world. We dare to live as God's people. In the years that I've been around Springfield, I understand that you have done great work with the people in our community. One of your hallmark givings to the community is Rainbow Table every Friday. And how many people typically show up to the Rainbow Table? The numbers that I heard were about 180 to 200.
Yeah.
And that it's lightly planned, and somehow there's always food for everyone who comes. There's no questions asked, so you can come just for the fellowship of the people gathered together. Or you could come because there was a great need for food that you did not have. On Tuesday, or is it Wednesday, when the food pantry is open, where people could come and take goods home to fill their own cupboards and supply the needs that they have. So in thinking about this text, you know, when people were hungry, you fed them. When they had a need, you gave it to them. When they were lonely, you provided an opportunity for them to visit with each other. And in caring for one another, I presume that has also taken place when you have given care to another person, or you have received care from someone who gave that care to you. For you see, in God's kingdom, we always need to be the one who gives or the one who receives, and it's as important for the one to give as it is for the one to receive. God's grace is amazing. And faith essentially is a verb, an action, a giving of yourself in a way that others may not give. Faith is an action. Faith is a verb. Faith is a gift that you give to others. The people who made it into the heavens in the gospel lesson were shocked. They had no memory of ever helping Jesus. They had no memory of assisting anyone who even looked like him. And perhaps the shock came about because there was a realization that Jesus was comparing himself to those who had bees. Jesus was comparing himself to those who had needs. He was the one who said he was hungry, he was tired, he was naked, he was in prison. He was identifying with the other as opposed to identifying with the people who gave the items. Perhaps their shock was because they couldn't imagine Jesus being in a position, you know, the creator of heaven and earth, Jesus the Son of God, ever being in need. And yet he places himself in that space and says, when you gave to me, when you give to the least of these, you have given to me. There was a homeless person who walked into a church. It was obvious that this person hadn't had a shower in a few days. It was obvious that his clothes had not a benefit of a washing machine, and no amount of shampoo had been wasted on his head. And the clothes that he wore were not his Sunday best. And the people in the congregation were uncomfortable. You could see them shifting in the pews, some to look at the fellow because he was unique, and others were looking in horror because that particular Sunday, the new candidate for pastor was going to be with them. And they were uncomfortable with the stranger in their presence. But there were those brave folks who took a hymnal and went and sat with the person and helped them wander through the hymnal service and befriended him. And then the service came to the place where the announcements were to be made, craned their necks looking for who that might be and what room had he been hiding. And they were looking at all of the doors, and all of a sudden this homeless-looking fellow comes up. And he goes and he stands in front of the congregation. And you see the gasps of horror and wonder. And then he says, "I am your new pastoral candidate." And the pastor who was presiding introduced him by name. But the fellow wanted to see and experience how the gift of welcome was done within that congregation. He wanted to see and experience how the stranger was given a home within that place of worship. He appreciated the acts of kindness, the gift of the bulletin, the one who would help him navigate through the service. He understood that this was a caring place where people would be cared for. And it helped him perceive who the congregation was as a group. It helped him understand that the people were people who would give of themselves. Because he knew that only when people could identify with one who had hardships could they give to that person in the hardship to encourage them to live another day. This last few months, the school at Osterlin has been putting together a newsletter. And the English arts teacher has been inviting the students to write stories. She said that some of the students just wrote, and they wrote long, long stories about ways to put on makeup, or ways to make friends or their favorite sport, which was football. One child wrote about going fishing and how she loved going fishing with her dad, and how many fish they would catch. She said they never caught too many. But I'd like to read to you two stories from here. And these are written by some of the youth at Osterlin. Says, the title is "Nobody is Perfect." It says, "I may not be the most beautiful, the sexiest, or the girl with the perfect body, but I don't pretend to be somebody I am not. I'm good looking. I'm good at being me. I might not be proud of my past, but I'm proud of who I am today. Don't forget that you are yourself. Do not let anyone control you in any way." And then she says with underlines, "Do not forget that. Nobody's perfect." And much like the goats who were separated on one side, they knew that they weren't perfect. Much like the kids who were challenged by the devil if they were perfect for the last 365 days, they knew they weren't perfect. But in Christ's world, in Jesus' world, we are all perfect in his eyes. Another student wrote a poem that says, "Do you have a good friend?" And this is from a personal perspective, and as a teenager who obviously hasn't always had the best of friends. And this person writes, "They say it is helpful to have a good friend. Good, faithful, and reliable friends can help you in many ways. Like having someone to talk to do fun things. It's good to have good people in your life because they can support you and help you get through difficult situations. Some friends are bad. They can get you into trouble, and they can also put you in something you don't want to do and have you fight for what you don't want to. For example, people may say that they got your back, but still they are putting you in something that can mess up your life. If you don't want people to be a bad influence on you, just watch who you are hanging around. So always find out who the good friends are and who the fake friends are. However, you should not judge a book by its cover, because some people prove to be helpful and supportive only when you need them. Friends in need are friends indeed. another one is this: appearances can be deceptive. Part of the experience at Osterland for our youth is the experience of consistency. The rules are consistent. And anytime I ask the students, so does the staff person ever break the rules just for you? And they look at me and they roll their eyes like any teenager will do, and they'll just shake their head and say, no. I said, well, what about this one over here? And they look at me and they say, oh, no, no, definitely not that person wouldn't bend the rules. Well, how about, I said, Pastor, don't even ask anymore. The rules are consistent. They don't change from one staff person to the next, and they don't change from one youth to the next either. We know what they are, and we know that we need to live within those rules. And they told me in that sentence that it was in knowing the rules they had a place that centered themselves. They knew what the rules were, and they knew what the consequences would be should they not live up to the rules. Now, that might not seem to be significant, but when you are a child and you've had traumatic experiences in life, you live with your hunch always up, always looking behind you, wondering when the next shoe is going to fall, when is the next moment that you're going to get tripped up by something you didn't think would. It is the consistency in the experiences at Osterland that help the children to place their roots down and to grow and thrive from there. It's amazing to watch the children live from day to day and month to month, and to see that even just in 9 short months, sometimes 12, that the youth come around and you see them carrying themselves differently. You see them understanding what it means to have a friend. And you see them judging each other in a good way and choosing the friends that are friends for friends' sake and not the friends who are going to trip them up in some way else. It is in that security that they can grow and thrive from there. When everything is as it should be, it is helpful to the student to work beyond that and to grow into life. A few years ago, the story was this from one of the students who had lived with at Osterland for quite some time. He had called Mr. Derek Young, our coordinator for residential, and he said, Mr. Derek, I want to tell you. And Mr. Derek was on the other side of the phone, and you could see that look of shock on his face. This person is calling me? But the youth continued, and he said, Mr. Derek, this Osterland was the 5th placement for me. I had been in 4 foster care homes that had failed, some to my own doing, some to not my own doing. But I wanted to get back in touch with you and say thanks to the Osterland staff and to yourself because you made a difference. I wasn't sure I wanted to live before I came to Osterland. In fact, I was sure that it wasn't worth living at all. But through your staff and through your hard love and through your tough love, I've learned that there is life that is worth living. And now, several years after I have left Osterland, I am living that life. And I want to thank you. He said, and Mr. Derek, I want to tell you that I'm a father now. I have a son, and he lives with me, and I'm going to do right by him. I'm going to raise him with the proper rules and give him that consistency that I received at Osterland. I'm going to raise him right, Mr. Derek. He won't have to see you as a resident later on. And with that, Mr. Dare hung up the phone, and he sat back for a while and just wondered and pondered and thanked God. Because you see, the fellow who had called back was a fellow he wouldn't have expected to call. In fact, he and the staff had pretty much concluded that this fellow was going to be seen again. or that his life was going to be spent behind bars. So for him to come back and to say thank you was a big deal. For him to come back and say, I really appreciate what you did for me, was huge. And it helped Mr. Derrick and the staff know that the work that is done there has profound footings in the youth's lives. And even though you may not expect any good to come out of that individual, never underestimate what God can do in the meantime. It's quite a joy to work at Osterlin and to see those changes take place. And it's quite a joy to see how the statistics look at the end of the year. I get to collect those statistics together, and it always amazes me that in our community counseling center, where we have 9 full-time therapists, there's about 15,000 hours of therapy that had happened in the last fiscal year. 15,000 hours for children from the age 3 to approximately 21. For the residential kids, we have 5,511 days of residence by the children who have lived there. It's a great place to be. It's a good place for the kids to come and settle in and to grow from where they are. It is a good place for them to understand social skills with each other. And we have great opportunities for the kids to work with things like goats. I'm sorry, we don't have sheep, we've just got goats. And chickens. We had a pig named Hamlet, but he has left us to go to another farm. And turkeys. And it's fun to watch the kids work with the chickens and the animals. And at the Clark County Summer Fair this past year, you may have seen some of those prize-winning chickens that were raised by our girls. It was quite fun to see the city girls come on in with that chicken tucked in under their arm, and the butt of the chicken facing outward, and the face of the chicken facing backwards. Apparently that's how you carry a chicken. And when I took a picture of the girls, I said, okay, I got the front side of you, or I want the front side of the chicken. Turn around, please, because I wanted to get the chicken head. The girls who had been working with the chickens for about 3 to 4 months each came in the first 5 places at the county fair. The daughter of the farmer, Kristen Barnett, received the grand champion for meat chickens. One of our youth and residents came in with the grand reserve champion, which is the second place. The third and the fourth place were also placed by the children at Osterlin. Farmer Jason would say, it took my daughter 9 years to get that first place. 9 years. He says, I can't believe what these girls have done in a few months. For they have risen to second, third, and fourth places in 9 months, or 3 months of time working with the chickens. And all I could think of is, Jason, they've learned well from you. Jason, you have the skills in teaching these youth how to live and grow and to work with chickens. And the best part was, in a social function where one of the girls' fathers was, he said, you know, we're going to have to find ourselves a place to raise chickens. We're going to have to move off to the country. Anybody got a problem? And so it is. In doing the least to these, we do to Christ. In giving of ourselves, we give of ourselves to Christ. I invite you to always be looking, always be comprehending, who is that one that needs to hear from you? Who is that one that is crying out in the wilderness for just that one morsel, that one drop of water to quench the thirst? Who is that one that looks pleadingly with their eyes? And you know that you have something that they been the ones who have given those gifts to others. And those are moments that typically bring tears to our eyes and lumps in our throats, because those moments are near and dear to us. And oftentimes they are life-defining moments. They are times when we knew for sure that we are a part of God's kingdom. It was a time when we knew for sure that God has his mind on us and tends to even our own particular needs. So I invite you always to be in prayer, thanking God for that which he has done, and inviting God to use you to work in his kingdom. For there is a lot of work yet to be done. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and for the breath of life that you have granted to us. Thank you for those moments in our lives when you have granted us those angels who have given us what was needed in that moment. We thank you for the promptings that you have given to us when others have needed something from us that only you could give. We give you praise, Lord, for tending to all of the details in life. I don't know how you do it, but you do. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. Let us sing the hymn, Bless Me the Tie That Binds.
Singing the sermon hymn today, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. This is Christ the King, Sunday, November the 26th, the last Sunday of our church year, and next Sunday will be Advent. Listen to Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, a very ancient hymn written in the 1700s. Blessed Be the Tie That Binds.
Surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us offer our prayers before God's throne. adversity and distress may have their hope renewed in your great mercy.
Hear us, O God.
God of comfort, uphold with the word of life all who are sick or hospitalized, for they may give thanks to you in your great mercy.
Hear us, O God.
God of grace, bless all developing and mission congregations, that they may be communities of lively fellowship, service, and witness in their neighborhoods, in your great mercy.
Hear us, O God.
God of the resurrection, bring us all with your saints to the promised day of judgment and mercy. Before the throne of Christ, our Savior, in your great mercy.
Hear us, O God.
Rejoicing in the communion of all the saints, let us commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us bring forth our offerings.
Time for our offering. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We have Linda Nelson Smith, our usher today, who are now receiving the offering plates from Pastor Bonnie, and we'll be taking up the offering. This is the Christ the King Sunday, 26th of November. We thank God for the role of Christ as King in our lives. We invite Jesus to come into our hearts. He'll be the ruler of our lives. He'll be with us throughout eternity, just as he has promised. Today we have, you can see the flowers, the beautiful flowers on the altar. They were given by Vicki, Tim, and Dan Perks in honor of Larry's birthday. Happy birthday to Larry Perks. The flowers are given in his honor. Less than Cindy Pearson and family in honor of Madeline and Michelle Everhart and Lillian Pearson's birthdays. Several birthdays are being celebrated today, and we have the flowers on the altar today. Remember that this is Christ the King Sunday. Jesus shall reign. He is King of our lives. He has died for our sins. We appreciate that, and we thanks be to God for that. We have a pastor, Pastor Bonnie, who's filling in for Pastor Pollock today. She is the pastor at Oastland Services for Youth. They have helped some children to have a reason to live. Beautiful stories that Pastor Bonnie gave to us today.
Trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead
Our closing hymn continues the theme of Christ the King. It was written by Isaac Watts, who lived in the 1600s, a father of English hymnology. He wrote about a hymn a week. Isaac Watts, Jesus shall reign wherever the sun. John's Lutheran Church. We're at the corner of Springfield. We're at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia in Springfield, Ohio. We invite you to worship with us any Sunday at 8 o'clock. Sunday school is 9:15 and church is 10:30. The Christian's job is to agree with God that every person you meet was worth Jesus dying for. That's our theme today. Jesus, we see Jesus' face in anybody that we help. We don't even realize it. As we have done it unto the least of these, my brethren have done it to him. The morning service is 8 a.m., 10:30 a.m. Midweek service is 6:30 p.m. in the chapel. Holy Communion is celebrated the first and third Sunday of each month, festivals, and each Wednesday evening. We invite you to come worship with us anytime. And as Pastor Bonnie talked today, come help us with the rainbow table. Help us to feed the hungry. Help us to clothe the naked. Help us in all the things that Jesus asks us to do. We ask you to come bring next Sunday is Holy Communion. And today we had service of the Word. We invite you to come and receive communion virtually next Sunday. Bring to the table at Christmas. We're collecting new and gently used coats, gloves, and toiletries, blankets for our annual holiday luncheon on Friday, December the 22nd. Bring items to the church by Friday, December the 15th. And the angel tree is in the atrium. We hope that you'll take one of the angel tags and purchase a gift for that angel. Come to our church and find out what the poor need. Gift is to be wrapped. The angel tag is placed at the top of the package. Return to church by December the 12th. It's the ministry of St. John's. Do not put gifts under the tree. Bring the gifts to the church office. We account for all the angel tags and make sure that we have the right amount of gifts. These are children who would not receive any Christmas, not for us. Today is Christ the King Sunday, November 26, 2017. We thank you for worshiping with us today. We hope that you will receive the blessing, that we'll do things for the least of these. And as we do it, we see the face of Christ. See the face of Christ every day as we are helping others. We invite you to come and join our ministry.